open up your mind and grab a book.
And your children will steal your credit card number to buy tickets to the Miley Cyrus Twerkers Ball.
Any yearly membership or better, we will be more than happy and delighted to send you an autographed copy of Washington Irving's biography of George Washington, Life of Washington, Volume 1, in the beautiful dust jacket. It's a beautiful hardback book. I am the editor. We revived that book from Founding Father Films Publishing. We revived that book. It was dead. And we digitized it and made it readable by modern readers with new footnotes and new illustrations. It's a fantastic history of the American Revolution. Yours free for a yearly membership at veritasradionetwork.com/join. And I will proceed to the events of today. If you don't know, at the turn of the 16th century, when young Henry VIII became the King of England, and we'll go through all this in the history, Henry VIII, began to dabble in the dark art of adultery, and I use art figuratively speaking, Henry, by all accounts, was a fantastic Catholic.
RadioNetwork.com.
He was even cited by the Pope. He was given a title by the Pope for his defense, as Defender of the Faith, I believe was the title.
Back right now, Ryan Granter was with us, and Ryan, who is also the proprietor of Mediatrix Press at MediatrixPress.com, a great resource for the kind of reading we should all be doing a lot more of. Ryan, the book that you sent, first of all, welcome to the My Church Show here on the Crusade Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network. How are you?
Thank you. I'm doing well. Thanks for having me.
You're very welcome. By the way, you look great in the tie and the smoking jacket. The only thing you're missing is the pipe today.
I know. I'm not able to smoke where I'm at, unfortunately.
Tell us about the book that we're about to that you edited for Mediatrix Press. That it's going to serve as about one third of the narrative that we're going to flesh out today. The one that you sent me as a PDF file.
The book is St. John Fisher, and it's a biography of him that was done in the 1950s by E.E. Reynolds, who is a church historian in England. The book originally, it was out of print for a very long time, and it was to augment an earlier book done in the 19th century by a priest named Bridget. I can't remember his first name. Bridget was an Anglican don at the University of Cambridge, and when he started studying the history of Cambridge and the constitutions, he discovered that it was just St. John Fisher who had basically established the College of Cambridge as it now exists, and reestablished it after it had fallen at a low point during the Wars of the Roses, and he was made, St. John's College, Cambridge. He was basically the founder and rector of that particular portion of the college. So then he just got into the life of John Fisher, and the more he read, the more he realized that there was a mistake made in the Reformation, and he left the Anglican Church and became Catholic, became a Catholic priest. So he wrote a biography of John Fisher. That was the first one ever to be done based on state papers and other things. So it's more a history than a hagiography. So Reynolds' work is an increase of that, because one of the things that Bridget did not have access to were the records in at the Diocese of Rochester. So Reynolds had gone through all of Fisher's work, his activities as recorded firsthand. He went to all the eyewitness accounts that survives, also state papers and an increasing number that weren't available to Bridget. So he takes all of the primary source histories as well as a 16th century biography of John Fisher that was rendered into modern English. He read that, used that for the source, as well as other other accounts and other histories that were really important. So this is a first rate history. It's not just a saint's books, his saint did so many miracles, blah blah blah. This is not to say that such pietistic literature is not good, but in terms of history, it's not what you rely on to be good. This is a history book as well as an elucidation of the saint's holiness.
And if you want more information on the subject, I'm going to post this. The video and the audio will be available for Founders Pass members, and you can find it at MikeChurch.com and at VeritasRadioNetwork.com. And I'm sure Ryan will concur with me on this. If you want an extra audio portion of this, head on over to KeepTheFaith.org and search for Michael Davies. And when you find Michael Davies, D-A-V-I-E-S, look for his lecture. I think, is there one part or two parts on John Fisher?
It's actually four.
It's in four parts. He covers the whole Reformation, right?
There's one where he covers the whole Reformation, and John Fisher makes one portion of that. There's another where he devoted about 4-hour-long talks to John Fisher,
right.
And the first one being on his holiness and his preaching, then the second, third, and most of the fourth on his quotes of Luther, and then the fourth one being the close of his life, many of which subjects we'll touch on today.
Yeah, and as I said, Ryan, you probably will concur with me. This is excellent story. This is great listening material at the lecture from Michael Davies, right?
It is. I hope to be well here, but I don't think I can do as well as Michael Davies. So.
If we escape the 2 hours and scratch the surface of the genius and the storytelling acumen of Michael Davies, I think we'll both walk away from this and feel like we had a good day. How about that?
I think so.
All right, well, let's get this started. Oh, before we get this started, I have I told you about this yesterday. I'm just going to show the YouTube audience. A family that listens to the Crusade Channel, and they all listen together, and they're probably watching on YouTube. Remember I told you there was a little boy who was ecstatic when he heard that we were going to do a show about Terry John Fisher. So, I want to throw a shout out here and a little dedication of the next 2 hours of this show to a young man that has actually made a devotion to St. John Fisher. So, ladies and gentlemen, just like to recognize, and I cleared this with his mother, so it's okay, I can say his name, to little 6-year-old Sam Parn, who has had a devotion to St. John Fisher since he was 3 years old. Here's what his dad writes me in part. Sam, the youngest little altar server, is very excited about your mentioning St. John Fisher, and he tells me that I may recognize him. Now, for some reason, to develop devotion to him 3 years ago, pretty odd thing for a 6-year-old at that time, and I guess he's 6, I guess he's 9 now. My apologies. He asked for his intercession every day for running jokes at rosary time and raises his hand at the end. And his intercessor was always St. John Fisher. And the whole family left. So, great story, a great way to start us off that St. John Fisher actually has young devotees whose lives he's already influencing. So, why don't we start appropriately with the life of young John Fisher, Ryan Grant?
Well, there's certainly a way to put the pressure on. nevertheless,
folks, no pressure at all.
St. John Fisher was born in 1459, approximately. Nobody's exactly sure on the date. And he was born in a city called Beverley, which is in the north of England, near York. And it was a town of cloth merchants. So this is, of course, during his youth, the War of the Roses is heating up. And just to get an understanding of the War of the Roses, Henry V, everybody knows of the Shakespeare fame, Agincourt, St. Crispin's Day speech and whatnot. He had, of course, was in striking distance of Paris and then cut a deal with the Capetian king that he would inherit France and marry the princess, and then he would become king of France upon the late king's death. Well, Henry, of course, died, and then his very young son, Henry VI, became the new king, right? Child king. But unlike a lot of children who become kings, Henry VI became very, very pious. So as a result of his piety, he wasn't so much interested in making war, and the English nobles in France had very little direction as the French were beginning to unify and get their direction ordered. And then, of course, preeminently with St. Joan of Arc appearing in France. And so the English ended up finally losing all of their holdings in France, except for Calais, which they historically held. And then, so there's a lot of consternation. You know, so Henry VI uses money to build monasteries, do a lot of good things, as well as patronize church music. And some of the nobility wasn't terribly happy, and especially the Yorkists. So the Yorkists were part of it. They're related to the royal family, the House of Lancaster, and they felt they should be in charge and not the Lancastrian house. So they began fighting against each other, which, you know, big bloody history we go into, which finally is won when Lady Margaret Beaufort is the last of the Lancastrian house, when Richard III manages to alienate all the Yorkist party by killing the two heirs to the throne, at least that's what everyone suspected. Then, one of their mother, Elizabeth, Elizabeth, she went to Margaret Beaufort, and they both agreed to bring her son Henry back from the exile in France, the last Lancastrian, Henry Tudor, and they would back him against Richard III, and then if successful, the Yorkists would marry, you know, into the Yorkists, and then that would complete the unification of the houses and end the war. So then, of course, this happened at the Battle of Bosworth. So all of this is going on while John Fisher is a child, yet he didn't see very much of it. Edward IV marched through with his armies one time. That was about as much as he saw of the war, because all the great trading towns were very important for the economy, and neither side in the struggle could afford to alienate any of the towns, so they had to respect the rights of the great trading towns. So now Beverly was a great merchant town, and St. John Fisher's father was a wool merchant and very wealthy. And had several children. Unfortunately, he died at some point. So then his widowed mother then was married to a man named White. So then, who also was a prosperous merchant. So Fisher's talents became evident very early. He was sent to a grammar school. And the way schools worked in the period, you learned the trivium, which is grammar, not English grammar, but Latin grammar, then logic, and then rhetoric. So grammar, learning how to speak, that is how to speak in Latin, which is the educated language. And that's all that mattered at this time, actually probably for the next two or three centuries. But all that would matter is eloquentia latina. If you knew Latin, then you could be of service to someone high up. And if you were, you know, very good at speaking, you could really advance yourself. So you had the logic, how to speak in an orderly and clear way that's intelligible, and speak, you know, true things. And then you finally have rhetoric, which is how to speak beautifully, how to please with the ear. So that's the course that he got, and he did extremely well in this, and the family was well enough off that once he got to his teenage years, he was able to go to Cambridge. And unfortunately, not much more is known about Fisher's youth, because just not a whole lot survives, and he didn't relate very much during his time as a bishop or in sermons. But one thing we know is that if we want to imagine his childhood, you know, Beverly is not, you know, unlike any other medieval town, right? In the 1400s, in spite of various dates people like to artificially construct, like the Renaissance, and now things are better than they were. Nobody would have noticed any change from the 1200s to the 1500s, except the advent of gunpowder, perhaps. So, and then the various changes in artwork. So the life was the same. It was still a very medieval town, Beverly. You still had the cultural life of the church, which was the minster, to use that old English word, which means the cathedral, or a very large church. It's called a minster. So Westminster, York Minster, all these things. And you would have the mystery plays, which, for example, why do you have a Christmas tree and why do you put apples on it, right? And that's the way they always used to be shown. Well, the Christmas tree, no, does not go to some pagan god or what have you. It goes actually to the medieval mystery plays, where they used to set up various mysteries that would commemorate the events of the Holy Bible. So that you'd have Genesis and even Cain and Abel, you'd have different, people would act out in different ways what had happened, going through the major scenes of the Old Testament, all the leading up to inside the church, enact all these mystery plays, so you have the creation of the world, and have somewhat sometimes be paraliturgical, so you had the fall of Adam and Eve. So the only tree that was green during the time of the mystery plays was the evergreen tree, it was a pine tree. So you used a pine tree, and you would put, and this is all common all over Europe, it's not just in England. And then you would read on it of some kind, so to show the forbidden fruit, which the only thing you had at hand at that time was apples. So that's what you would take. And that's where the ultimately, through a lot of different changes and ceremonies by the German royal houses and whatnot, that's where we get the Christmas tree, ultimately.
So just that. That's a fascinating story. Of course, that's all illegal to that, folks. You can't do any of that.
That's right. You got to celebrate Kwanzaa or something.
Right. And that's where the 12 days of Christmas, there's part of the story of the 12 days of Christmas is actually contained in some of what you just said. Because some of the pieces, some of the two turtle doves, or of course that's the sacrifice that was made when our Lord was presented. And it's all part of the medieval tradition, which was very rich at that time. See, we tend to think of Christmas time as, I've got to go to Best Buy, I've got to go to Kmart, I've got to go to Macy's. They thought of it in a very reverent manner and probably looked forward to making all these presentations that you just described. So this is kind of the world that young St. John Fisher was growing up in Beverly, England, as we're describing it. This is the Crusade Channel. It's the Mike Church Show on the Crusade Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network, radio the way it should be. It's a very special live edition of the Mike Church Show. On a Wednesday afternoon, the life and times of St. John Fisher. And our special guest is Ryan Grant. He is the proprietor of Mediatrix Press, and you can get the work that we're talking about here in part at Mediatrix Press. If you go to mediatrixpress.com, pick up the book about that. Thank God Fisher there today. It's on the front page. Check it out for myself today. Ryan, so at a very young age, we know that a young man who wanted to be productive or who wanted to serve in some other capacity to the professional or the ecclesiastical class or the religious class, they would have to learn Latin. Many of them learned Greek as well, right?
Some did. It was coming back into England at that time very slowly. They had it at Oxford, and that was about the only place in England you could learn Greek, until Fisher's time at Cambridge, where he brought in Erasmus of Rotterdam. We'll talk about that a little later, to teach Greek at Cambridge. And so, but principally, you learned Latin. And then if you were a tradesman, you would learn some Latin as well, because if you went to the Low Countries, that is Flanders, where today Belgium and Holland, where a lot of the wool was bought and then weaved into whatever, that's where you would make a lot of profit. And of course, if you didn't know Flemish and you didn't know what we now call Dutch, then you would have to find something else to speak in. So maybe French, like if you're in areas like around the Rhythm Walloons and whatnot, the French part, speaking part of Belgium, or you would know Latin. And Latin was a spoken language in the Netherlands for hundreds of years after, even in our other portion of the Crusade Channel, we talked about Robert Bellarmine. When he was brought to Louvain to preach, he was preaching a series of Latin sermons there about 100 years after Fisher. So it was still not just for the students, but also for the faithful who would come to listen to it who were not Flemish speaking. So Latin continued to be useful even for the lower classes for a very long time. But nevertheless, so that was the thing. And so Fisher learned it very well, being, a product of his environment, a medieval Christian. There is no question that the church is the church, right? Because it's still pre-Reformation. So those battles are in the future. So, this is simply the truth. And at some point, he determined that he had a vocation and he had the wealth, because in that time, there's no seminary yet, so we have to discard what we know of the seminary system since Trent. You go and you discern a vocation, you get accepted into a diocese or religious order. They send you away for 7 years of education or so in rigorous training in philosophy, theology, whatnot. And then you become a priest, and then, you come out as a reasonably well-educated person, hopefully. And so you've got to wonder today with some people, but nevertheless. Then you have, in the Middle Ages, it's mostly on the apprentice system. So if you thought you had a vocation, you'd talk to the priest, they'd talk to the bishop, and then that priest would train you in everything you needed to know to become a priest, right? So if he knew his stuff and he was very well learned and educated, there's a very good chance you will be too. If he's not, then there's a very good chance you're not really going to know much at all. And unless you get patronage to be able to go to the universities. And if you're, somewhat more well off, then you could afford it. So in Fisher's family, they were far more well off. So he was able to go to Cambridge, and he made the journey on foot, about 150 miles or so, and took up his residence at Cambridge, where he started. And then, of course, in those days, the course of studies, you would become then first a master of grammar. Right, and so you would be trained to now teach like you would at the grammar schools, and then you would also take a master of philosophy in other things. So Fisher took his degrees in the 1470s, and so I mentioned earlier the backdrop of the War of the Roses, and now this is where that world meets Fisher's world. Is Lady Margaret Beaufort? There was a dispute between Cambridge and some of the local areas, and so they sent a deputation of people from Cambridge, one of whom was now Father John Fisher, who had been ordained. And he was ordained, I believe, by Bishop Richard Fox, if I'm not mistaken. But in any event, so he was now a priest, and he was also a doctor from Cambridge. And so he was sent along with several others from Cambridge, and he made a very lasting impression on Lady Margaret Beaufort, who's the mother of King Henry VII, Henry Tudor, right? There was the grandmother of Henry VIII. So Margaret Beaufort, was a very pious woman. It became more so under Fisher's direction, but he immediately made an impact on her. So just by his holiness, his manner of life, as they said in those days, your holy conversation, which meant conversation isn't what we mean today. It actually meant the way you live, your manners and everything else. So immediately she made him her confessor. and then also endowed the college with a lot of endowments and grants. Excuse her, you know, gave her direction. And so she took time. She was a big patron of printing. Caxton, I believe, is the one who printed the very first book in England. And so she was a patron of the printing press, which still remembers extremely new technology at this point. It's like, well, to use a phrase, it's hot off the press. It's a brand new technology.
This is Lady Margaret Beaufort, who is Henry VII's mother, right?
That's right.
Okay, that's what we're talking about here. I mean, we have some slides of Lady Margaret, I think, that we could show the video audience here. This is my third show here on the CRUSADE Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network, radio the way it should be. Our special TV drive live edition here of The Laughing Times with St. John Fisher. And you might have noticed that my subtitle was, Once Upon a Time, Marriage Was Actually Worth Losing Your Head Over. Which is true, of course, St. Thomas More, who would be brutally executed in the same fashion that our hero in this story will be on today, 1535, would be brutally executed on the 6th of July for the exact same crime, which is murdering with Henry VIII, who we'll get to in a moment here. Our special guest is Ryan Grant, he of Mediatric Press at mediatrix.com. Just to put this into context, and we'll get to this by the end of the story, a very young St. John Fisher is a priest, the confessor of Henry VIII's grandmother. Now, you'll need to know this because when we get to the end of the story and we start talking about what Henry VIII does to St. John Fisher, you'll begin to realize that what he's doing is to a very, very withered and frail and nearly dead old man. And I just want to say that that's why this marker is important, to recognize that this man, St. John Fisher, starts his young life off as the confessor of the grandmother of Henry VIII. And we'll pick it up from there. So that's where you were talking about Father John Fisher now. And do we know what parish he was at? Or was he still in Beverly, or had he been assigned somewhere else in England?
He had not actually been assigned a parish yet.
Okay.
And it may have happened at some point, but he was actually elevated at Cambridge and had a very important position there. And then he had a special position given to him by Lady Margaret Beaufort, apart from being her confessor. She also established a readership at Cambridge. And so the readership meant that basically you were supposed to lecture and different things, and also you had to preach. And so she gave special funds to enable preachers. Now, this is one of the big problems prior to the Reformation that church reformers and humanists were striving to correct somehow. It is that, and I mentioned earlier, the apprentice system. If the priest who went ahead of you was worth his salt, then you got a very good education and you did very well. If he was not, you were pretty lousy, and often were not given faculties to preach. So the problem is, bishops, you had what's called pluralities in absenteeism. So pluralities meant that the bishop was actually the bishop of several dioceses, and he had a salary paid by the diocese to him.
Okay.
And then he could take it. So then you have absenteeism. What do you do with all this money? Why be a bishop some podunk place over here when I could go to Rome, or I could go to Paris, or I could go to this other big city and live there on the income that's coming from the city? So like Milan, for example, becomes a notorious example of the absenteeism, so that when St. Charles Borromeo takes up the bishopric of Milan in the 1560s, he's the first bishop of Milan to reside in 5 years. That's it's pretty bad.
Wow.
So it wasn't quite as bad in other places. So the bishop is gone, and instead he appoints a vicar that he has to pay, but a paltry amount compared to what he's getting. Then the vicar has to make the determinations who will and will not have faculties to preach. And so a lot of times you have the religious orders would have the faculties to preach, like the Dominicans, especially that was their charism, is why they're called the Ordo Predicantium, the Order of Preachers, and you had to, get these faculties to preach. Otherwise, you were a simplex priest. And just being ordained didn't mean you could go out and preach. See, that today, it's different, whereas if you're ordained, automatically you have faculties to preach. And they would never think of pulling your faculties to preach, even when they probably should. So the back then, even if you were fairly sharp and everything, you might not get the faculty to preach. So Fisher quickly established himself as an excellent preacher, and with a great allusion. So his style of preaching comes frequently from the Holy Scripture, from also from the Church Fathers, but not too many in his popular sermons. So in like the Seven Penitential Psalms is a well-known collection of his sermons that have survived. It's been put into a modern edition, which you can read. I think you can actually find a modern edition on archive.org, unless I'm entirely mistaken. And so these sermons that he gave, vast majority of quotations, over 100, are from Scripture. And they're not just like a sermon that's loaded up with quotation after quotation. They're actually interwoven into the text very carefully. So then another thing to remember is the people of this time, they are illiterate. So nobody can just go and pick up a book and start reading, right? And that's one of the barriers to putting the Bible out there in the vernacular. You know, you'd be taking the time to translate it, and nobody would be able to read it except the educated class, which can already read it because it's in Latin. So even though, in spite of that, of course, vernacular Bibles had been done. They've been done in French, they've been done in Spanish, they've been done in German, before Luther even. The only exception was in England, because positive law was against it, and that's because of John Wycliffe, and we'll talk about him in a little bit. So as a result, so the preachers then, when they did preach well, they used copious quotes from the Scripture constantly in order, and so the people knew the Scripture very, very well, probably with the exception of the 19th century. I would say in most ages, people in this time knew the Bible better than most people subsequent to this period when it became in the vernacular and printing was available, because they weren't used to reading, so they're used to memorizing the vast majority of what they heard, what was preached. And that's what made the stained glass windows make sense. That's what made their common life and the sacraments and the ceremonies of Mass make sense, is what was preached. So I just give a little excerpt from Fisher's treatise on the Seven Penitential Psalms. It won't be terribly long. First, it was preached for Lady Margaret Beaufort's household, and then she encouraged him to expand on it and preach it wider, as he did. And so he went and preached to the people in various cities where he went. Quote, "That these holy psalms be like as letters of supplication, the which we may give unto Almighty God, as ready movers and stirrers of his infinite mercy for us, shall be made open on this wise. If peradventure any person have a matter of business with the King's Highness, and in his cause greatly desire his goodness and pity, will he not shortly go unto some wise man in such matters, and desire a letter of supplication for it to be made diligently, whereby he may cause the King's pity in his business to be obtained and had? Truly, his trust is not only in his own wisdom, for to be so bold in handling his matter and to purpose it only by his own words or his own wit. We sinners be in like condition, for truly we have many matters in the high court of the Most High King, Almighty God, for the which it should be profitable and necessary, the pity of God, to be purchased for us. And who is more wise in that court for our business to be sped, that is to say, for forgiveness to be obtained, than is our prophet David, that committed before the peril and danger of the same thing himself? Verily, he was a sinner as we be, and a busy follower of forgiveness. With great diligence he made these holy psalms, which he daily offered up unto Almighty God with great devotion as letters of supplication, by which he moved greatly his goodness for to forgive him. Therefore, we, knowing the virtue and efficacy of these holy psalms, let us use them in our like business, and doubt not to have forgiveness if we do it so lovingly as he did in his time." Unquote. So that's just a short little excerpt from the the treatise on the Psalms.
Okay.
Pardon. So then, because the Seven Penitential Psalms, you know, they're still prayed today. St. Thomas More, for example, prayed them very devoutly. And it was something that was reprinted many times in English within Fisher's own lifetime. So even for the educated class, it was very, very important. So quickly he gained this reputation as a very great preacher, and also having holy life, and many times he was observed by King Henry VII himself. Now, King Henry VII is remembered very negatively in the history, and for good reason. He did do a lot of bad things in his early reign because he was insecure. He was essentially seen especially by the Yorkists, as a usurper. And then there was a major threat to his throne when a Flemish man named Perkin Warbeck, was seen by some nobles, and he seemed to bear a resemblance to Edward V, who was the uncrowned young Yorkist king that was murdered in the Tower. St. Thomas More said in his history of Richard III that Richard III ordered the young king and his brother to be smothered, right, the heirs of Edward IV. And then, so then Richard III took the title for himself. You know, it's one of those mysteries we don't know, but nevertheless, probable. So
we get this picture here emerging as we go along, and we're just at the beginning of this. The English are some vicious and vile people when they want to be. And the English clown, no wonder they, and you have to imagine that when Puritans and Anglicans and other Protestant revolutionists, when they left England and then went to the Netherlands and then came to what we call the United States today, that some of the animus towards kings must have been fresh in their minds of some of the history that you're recanting here, or that you're recounting here about the Henrys and the Edwards killing the sons and killing off daughters. And you'll hear more of this from Henry during the time of Henry VIII as well. This picture emerges, if you read anything about this era, this epoch in history, that the English crown, the English royalties and the nobles did not have a problem with executions. As a matter of fact, they didn't have a problem with vicious, unthinkable mutilations that would pass for executions. And I just wanted to drop that in to kind of put all this into perspective, that even though that this is at the waning days and at the end of what we call Christendom, or Christendom today in England as it existed, you can already see that there is a streak that runs through the royal house that ultimately will rear its ugly head during the time of St. John Fisher, and then after St. John Fisher, and through the reign of Elizabeth, the reign of Bloody Elizabeth. I just wanted to interject that as a little bit of a perspective. So we're still discovering the life of young St. John Fisher here on the day that commemorates his martyrdom on the 22nd of June, 1535. Of course, today is the 22nd of June, 2016, and we're right in the middle of our discussion. So let's pick up where we left off here. So we're still in very young. About how old is St. John now? In his early 20s?
He's in his late 20s. He was ordained at he was brought into orders, to the first rungs of orders, at age 22, which was below the mandatory age. So he actually had to get a papal dispensation from Alexander VI in order to get ordained. But this wasn't hard to get, because in those days, you'd get almost anything out of the Pope if the money was good and if it was for some purpose. So that would seem beneficial, so that if you had the right connections and whatnot. And, of course, the bishop that had him ordained had the right connections in Rome.
Right.
And that's an abuse we'll get to in a little bit when we get to Luther. So
okay.
Fisher, then, he's probably in about his late 20s as he's Lady Margaret's confessor. And already, so now, you know, Henry VII is observing him and actually is moved by him in a great deal, a great passion, in as much as he sees St. John Fisher and his holiness and his probity and everything, and the effect also in his mother's holiness and all those prayers, and it moves him. So he changes gradually. So he's called the Winter King. And this is, of course, what St. Thomas More called him in a poem that he wrote on the occasion of Henry VIII's succession in 1509. So he's called the Winter King because, you know, he had tried to strangle, you know, in order to stop insurrections, like what happened with Perkin Warbeck, because many of the Yorkists gave their names to him, you know, under the guise that he was really one of the Yorkist princes in the Tower, who would have the proper claim to the throne rather than Henry Tudor. So so Henry, in order to stop it, there was a range of executions. He was also busy squeezing all the life and the money out of the Yorkists by taxation. And so then he became very miserly. But towards the end of his life, he starts to change, and he starts to do penance. And so he establishes monks at various abbeys to pray for his soul after he's died and various other things. And so seeing Fisher's holiness of life, he decides to make Fisher a bishop in 1504. So now that kind of surprised people, it wasn't based on the connections. And Henry VII affirmed, as we now know from Reynolds's work, that Henry VII affirmed that Fisher's holiness and his goodness of life and his zeal for souls is that which motivated Henry to name him the Bishop of Rochester in order to make atonement for the various evils he had committed during his reign. And this, you know, of course, you'd think that would be the qualification or the mandatory qualification for anyone being a bishop in this time. But it simply wasn't so. Really, the popes would do basically rubber stamp whoever as long as the money was right, namely because you're this tax. It's called the annates, which meant that the entire first year's income of a bishopric was the bishop's salary was payable to the pope whenever you appointed a bishop. So under that situation, it didn't matter who it was. As long as they get the money, hey, why not? And this is why the Renaissance papacy was so loathed, and humanism tended to drift toward the idea that the papacy may not be a divine institution because of the corruption that had creeped in at so many different levels. So, and we'll get more onto that as the story, you know, passes on.
Can we stop now and do a little discussion here about what humanism is?
Humanism is, it was called at the time the New Learning.
Okay.
And it was a primacy. So it still used the system of the medieval schools, which, at that time was still held in high regard. It's just that certain of their vehicles had kind of gotten to a low ebb. They had poorer teachers. And so humanism was an attempt to get back to the sources, recovering classical Latin, recovering classical Greek. And this was spurred on by so many Greeks coming from Constantinople. I mean, Greek was already spoken in Europe, in Western Europe. It was being taught in some places, especially in Italy, but not uniformly. So Greeks would come from Constantinople or flee the Turks. And then if you could teach it, well, you got yourself an instant job somewhere.
Right.
And so what a great way to pick up somewhere else. And so the new learning, so-called, was, you know, this humanism that focused on all the sources of the tradition. And it had, gave a parallel of excellence to Greece and ancient Greece and Rome, to classical Latin, especially Cicero, and looked less to the Middle Ages. And there's, of course, you see in humanists like Luigi Valla or Petrarch, or Boccaccio, that these guys have a lower view of the Latin that came before them, medieval Latin. And of course, they prejudiced the tradition in Latin scholarship largely against medieval Latin, which is very sorely. So even the editors of the lexicon of all Latin, Fortulini, when he looks at the Latin of St. Augustine's age, he calls this the low level of barbarism. You're just scratching your head. Did he ever read St. Augustine? I don't think so. But he's too prejudiced by where the tradition has been led at that point to even really look into and examine it. So humanism kind of puts an elevation of the glory of the classical world. And of course, which again puts the focus on the early church. What was the early church like? What kind of practices did they have? Didn't they really go back to the simplicity of the gospel? And look at all these accretions over the ages, benefices, pluralities, absenteeism, bishops, sacraments, things that, they couldn't all afford just by reading the Bible. Or some of them, they're implicitly, but not, completely unpacked. And so a lot of questioning is going on, which is good, and the church patronized this level of questioning. Same thing in art. But what was happening now is the questioning was starting to become a little more normal. So then once you hit the Reformation, the church kind of has to put the brakes on a lot of things. So the same thing in art, right? Art was there to depict the mysteries of religion. But then as we go a little bit further in the Renaissance, in the 1500s especially, now art is telling you what religion is rather than vice versa. So that's why, after the Reformation, most especially after the sack of Rome in 1527, which will factor into this story as well, actually. That's when they start clamping down on artwork, too. So you have that same famous scene with Veronese, where he painted the Last Supper of Christ, and then they're scrutinizing it because there's all these weird elements in it, a monkey, German soldiers were not, they really didn't want to see those. And so then, he's like, artistic license. And they say, well, no, we can't have any of that. So then he renames it Supper in the House of Levi. And then he didn't change anything in the painting, of course, but... So the church had to kind of put the brakes on humanism a little bit, but that was later. So in the beginning, it was, this focus, and Fisher was a big humanist. He was very well learned in the ancient sources. He was very well learned in, especially in the classical style of Latin. A lot of things show the marks of Cicero or Latin versions of the Greek order, Demosthenes and others. He clearly had this marks, and you see this come out in some various sermons, various important sermons he would preach shortly after being made a bishop. So in 1508, or 1509, I'm sorry, Lady Margaret Beaufort and Henry VII both die. And so as a bishop, Fisher had been noted for preaching to the people, something most bishops in this time never did because they were living in other cities or they just couldn't bother. They had others go out and do it for them.
Right.
Fisher went and saw all the people in order to preach. Now, Rochester was a small enough diocese where it could be accomplished, where he could make all these visitations and actually preach within 1 year in almost all the places in his diocese. It was also a very poor diocese, and it was considered the stepping stone on your ecclesiastical career going up. So during Fisher's lifetime, he would actually be offered very rich dioceses that paid him almost 10 times the salary. So Lincoln, for example, he was offered to be the Bishop of Lincoln, and that salary would have been 10 times what he made as the Bishop of Rochester, and he refused to take it. And he said that would be like deserting a poor, wife for a richer one. So he refused to ever consider it.
Have you ever seen the Paul Giamatti film, Ironclad?
I don't believe so, no.
The reason I bring it up is because this is a 12th century treatment of the reign of King John II, and it's about the sacking of the castle at Rochester. This is after the Magna Carta, and after King John says, well, I didn't really mean all that, and he starts telling the barons, he basically tries to renege on his kingly part of the Magna Carta. And the movie dramatizes that the castle in Rochester is where the principal barons were held up. And there was a siege of Rochester. And they ultimately smoked them out of there using pig carcasses, which they dug a tunnel. Anyway, it's a pretty good movie if you're into ancient English history. And it's called Ironclad. As a matter of fact, there's Ironclad and there's Ironclad 2 now. And Paul Giamatti plays King John II. And it's all about, again, the sacking of Rochester. I just thought I'd throw that in. Ryan, why don't we hold it there and take our first time out?
All right, let's do that.
And come back, and so we'll have the story's coming up now that St. John has been made a bishop. And then I assume that we'll get into a little bit of the history of who is it that succeeds Henry VII, and then what happens to him. And then Henry becomes king, and then Anne Boleyn enters. And it's an exciting part of the story. You're not going to want to miss any of this. This is the Mike Church Show here, and we are a very special live edition of the show today here. We are live with our Latin expert for our Modern Wrong World Made Right. Calvin was wrong, and we're on episode number 16 of that today. We're just talking about the life and times of St. John Fisher here on the day that he was martyred, on June the 22nd of 1535. So we'll pick up with this with Ryan Grant here. And he, if you're interested in the book about St. John Fisher, you can get it at the website at Mediatrix Press. That's Mediatrix Press.com. And just look for the picture of St. John Fisher, scroll down. And you'll find it right there. We will take our time out. This is the Mike Church Show here on the Crusade Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network. Radio the way it should be.
Hang on.
Yeah, something like that. Put him back up for a second. Hey, Ryan, I can't find that music. Where did you upload it to the Dropbox?
I put it in the Dropbox. It should be in there. The past time with good company.
Oh, you put it in Calvin was wrong?
I put it in Calvin was wrong, yeah.
Oh, that's why I can't find it.
Okay, sorry about that.
No, I got it. Oh, all right, there it is.
24/7 at VeritasRadioNetwork.com. Is there a hidden story contained within the New Testament? Did God orchestrate the writing of these books to share an incredible message? Could 3:16 have a deeper meaning? Is this all just a coincidence or divine inspiration? If you want to truly make a difference in someone's life that you care about, get them 3:16, The Story of God, written by best-selling author Dr. Michael T. George. Be a part of sharing the most important message ever told, truth. To get your copy of 3:16, The Story of God, go to Amazon.com or 3:16.life. That's 3:16.life. And pre-order your copy today of 3:16, The Story of God, written by best-selling author Dr. Michael T. George. For additional information about the book and the author, visit MichaelTGeorge.com. 3:16, The Story of God. Get it today. You know what I'm sick of? Darned Yankees versus the Red Sox. The Holy Reds versus the Evil Blues. As if evil's got to have a color assigned to it to rot your soul. I'm sick of liberals that think killing babies is exercising some sick form of liberty. Tell the truth, I'd like to see them do some spiritual exercises in a confession. And what is it with these clowns riding around?
of a Saint, that you can get at and read at mediatrixpress.com. That's mediatrixpress.com. And we've been giving a little bit of the biography, the background of the life of young John Fisher, soon to, who is now father and now Bishop Fisher. And we are at the state of the moment in our story where all the players that are going to become part of the controversy that ultimately contributes to the martyrdom of John Fisher, who would then become St. John Fisher, are all about to enter into the fray. And so we'll go back to Ryan Grant now. And Ryan, we were just wrapping up about the about Margaret, Lady Margaret Beaufort having passed away, Henry VII having passed away, and now this makes room for Henry's eldest son. I think my history is right. That's Richard, right?
No, let me cut in here. Well, we're almost getting all the players. Let's backtrack for the royalist history.
Okay.
That's necessary here. So Fisher, when he becomes a bishop, also becomes part of the Privy Council under Bishop Robert Fox, and who was the Lord Privy Seal, and then Bishop Warham, who for a time is the Chancellor, and he was the Archbishop of Canterbury. So this is 1504.
Right.
Bishop does this. Now we need to backtrack just a little bit. So I mentioned, of course, that Henry Tudor is in a very insecure position on the throne. But he's gifted. He has a son, an oldest son, and he names him Arthur. Now, Arthur is to hearken to England's national myth of King Arthur and things of this. So now there's a restoration after the bloody War of the Roses, where we've spent all the glory of English, the flower of English chivalry on the battlefields all across England for nothing. So now we're going to restore, again, the whole idea of the Tudor monarchy is all restoration. So you see the very symbol is the Tudor rose, a white rose inside of a red rose, the red rose of York and the white rose of Lancaster, now united into one symbol of the English monarchy. So that, and that, of course, remains the Tudor rose all the way until the accession of the Stuarts.
Okay.
So the issue then for Henry is now he has an older son, and then finally in 1491, the next son is born, Henry. And so Lady Margaret Beaufort records in her Book of Hours, the birth, and the Book of Hours is the book that royalty kept that had your scriptures, had your psalter, it had your, you know, various devotions and parts of the breviary, like the office of the Blessed Virgin Mary and things of this sort. So in the front, of course, there's, you note death, births and deaths and such in the family. So the birth of Henry is noted, but it was scratched out. If you can actually see the original in the British Library, I think it's digitized. I might be mistaken on that. But in the British Library, they have the original. And Lady Margaret Beaufort's Book of Hours in 1491 is added on top of a scratch-off because she couldn't remember. And the reason she couldn't remember is because it wasn't important. He was the spare. Right? Arthur was the heir. Henry was the spare. He was never supposed to rule. So therefore, their upbringings are very different. They didn't even know each other. Arthur was sent to Ludlow Castle in Wales, where the Prince of Wales had been trained, you know, ever since. So I mentioned before the rebellion of Perkin Warbeck, and this is the first time where Henry becomes of some importance anyway, because he's raised with his mother largely, and he's about 5 years old, and the Warbeck rebellion rises up claiming to be Edward V. And so and he claims to be the Duke of York. So Henry needs to meet this counterfeit Duke of York with a real Duke of York, and therefore he names his second son, his spare, who up to now wasn't really that important, as the Duke of York. And this, so now we have a real Duke of York to be opposed to the counterfeit Duke of York. And so Henry is brought into the cathedral in London, in St. Paul's, on horseback. And he's officially knighted by his father as a knight, right? And so this is, remember, we're still in the Middle Ages, this is about 1502, unless I'm mistaken. I can't remember the day. No, we're earlier even. 1497, I think. Either way, so he's brought inside, he's knighted, right? And this is what every boy aspires to, knighthood. Henry later would be noted for his jousting and his love of the joust and all the medieval games, just as they were. And so this is like the first moment where he's now brought in to the, you know, to the order of chivalry, the order of the garter, all these different things that meant something in those days. So the Warbeck Rebellion is defeated because the Cornish and the Welsh and the Yorkists that joined them got blocked off by the Thames, which acted like a moat, and then Henry VII was able to materialize his forces on the other side and crush them. So that was the end of the Warbeck Rebellion. But it reminded him, of course, of how weak his position was. Well, nevertheless, so now Henry is a knight, and he gives himself over, of course, to chivalrous actions and, you know, learning about, you know, poetry, much like a certain Spaniard, which I'll mention here in the course of events. But he's brought into this whole knightly court cult of chivalry and romance and so many different things. He's raised mostly with his sisters. Then something tragic happens in the Tudor family. Arthur dies. He was married to the Spanish princess Catherine of Aragon, and Henry actually gave her away in place of her father at the wedding, ironically. And he marched her down the aisle, even though he was a boy at the time. And then Arthur dies. And so Elizabeth Woodville, never the wife, the queen, the wife of Henry VII, she never recovered. She dies. And so Henry VII spends out his, you know, last days as a widow. Now Henry, the future Henry VIII, is now the heir. So now they take his education seriously. So they bring in various humanists, and now Henry's going to get all, you know, whipped up into shape, educationally speaking. So now he's taken off to Ludlow Castle to learn the ways of a prince. And in the meantime, Catherine, who now is the queen, or the princess dowager, dowager is a term from that time, means the widow. And she gets a dowry, you know, a payment, except that her father, Ferdinand of Aragon, the husband, the widowed husband of Queen Isabella, hadn't been paying the dowry. It didn't seem any more use to her. The match with England didn't seem any more useful. Henry Tudor wasn't sure whether he should try to marry her to his other son. But Henry was in love with her. Mm. And he married her for love. And we'll get to that in a minute. So Henry VII, of course, will pass on in 1509, well, in the midst of all this political rankling over the divorce. And a little thing happens here, too. Before Isabella dies, she is really concerned about her daughter, and so she looks at, you know, and gives the testimony that her daughter was never actually carnally known by Arthur, according to her daughter. And so this is sent to Pope Julius II, who's the Pope in Rome, when they're seeking the dispensation for her to marry Henry VIII, Catherine of Aragon to marry Henry VIII. And so when they look at the matter, he writes it in such a way where it could be read where the dispensation was dispensing if, in fact, she was carnally known, and if, in fact, she wasn't, doesn't matter. So he made sure to write it in good legalistic fashion, cover both possibilities. So that's an interesting story that'll resurrect its ugly head to the loss of someone else's a bit later.
Yes,
so
it will.
In the meantime, so then Henry, then in 1509, comes to the throne and then ends all these problems instantly by marrying Catherine for love. And he writes to Ferdinand, who's still the king of Spain and Aragon, and he says that she excels in all virtues and all probity, and if he was free, even now, he would still choose her. And in fact, it all started out very well. Right, so Henry's this interesting figure because he's the tyrant, fat, overeating, who's killed, who beheads two of his wives and puts away two others, and survives one and is survived by the last one. It's a soap opera and a drama of the highest proportions. Yet, at the same time, the real Henry is much more complex. And the early Henry, you don't see the tyrant. You see young, fun-loving boy, prince of the church, right, loves the church.
Right, right.
You know, considers himself a great theologian, handsome, youthful, thin, not fat. And he is, considers himself a very good theologian. In reality, he was really well-instructed layman. Nevertheless, I mean, he was fluent in Latin, according to the Venetian ambassador Justiniani wrote back to the Republic in Venice that Henry was fluent in Latin, in Italian, in Spanish, and in French, that he was well-learned in philosophy and the latest in humanism, and also was given to hunting and play and courtly activities. So, interestingly, when Henry was a boy, Fisher, when he was Lady Margaret's confessor, was brought in to assist in Henry's Latin education and to bring him up a little bit. And so there's several things that Fisher had done for Henry in his life that go unthanked in the end. We'll mention each of those in turn. So Fisher was known to the king because he had tutored him and helped him become a crossover from reading Latin out of books to becoming fluent in it and thought. And then as part of the Privy Council, he would also be known to the king. So Henry comes to the throne in 1509, and he comes with two specific determinations. One of them I already mentioned was to marry Catherine for love. The second determination is to rekindle the Hundred Years' War after his hero, Henry V, and go defeat the French. That's a great idea, except that England wasn't what it was back then. And right. France isn't what it was back then. France is a much stronger, more unified country since the time of Charles VIII, Charles VII, thanks to Joan of Arc, and also Charles VIII. And also then Louis XII. Also, Louis XII had managed to really unite the nobles under him for his campaigns in Italy. So Henry then is, you know, deciding he's going to make war. So he gets everything together. There's a lot of appeal for it, but he's stopped because he's inherited this Privy Council from his father, made up of Archbishop Warham, Bishop Fox, and many others, including John Fisher. So they, more or less kind of manage affairs for Henry. And Henry, one of the things this conflict reveals is that he's very, in spite of everything, he's not a confrontational sort of person. He likes to handle things through intermediaries. He doesn't want to be directly in your face fighting you. And this will come back again during the trial with Catherine. We'll see what happens. But so he just kind of takes it in stride and goes off. And he's not allowed to joust either. He wants to joust. And one of the things he had done in order to win the respect of the Yorkists, to cut down the threat of revolution when he became king, was to become friends with all the Yorkist jousters. And so by doing that, they all considered Henry a friend, and Henry bestowed great gifts of money and things upon him. So he was really eager to joust, but he couldn't. So he gave himself in hunting and play. There's a song he wrote, too, which I'm sure you'll play in the course of the show. It's called Pastime with Good Company. And one of the refrains in there is, who shall me let, which in the English of that time means, who shall stop me from having fun? And he makes his move. There he goes in secret and jousts. And this was to the shock of the Privy Council, which did forbade him from doing it, really, really challenged them. So they put one of their junior proteges, and here we get one of the next major players in this whole saga, Thomas Wolsey, who was a cleric, who was a bishop, a minor bishop, and he was made to be, they made him Henry's chaplain with the explicit orders to put the brakes on his youthful mirth. And so Henry Wolsey, who was from an Ipswich innkeeper, who's he was a very dodgy character, he's always on the wrong side of the law. His name shows up in the writing the town council's accounts for people who are fined for running what's called an unclean house, that is running a brothel on the side of the inn. Right, so Wolsey escaped what was going to be largely the same dodgy life by learning Latin in the grammar schools offered by the monks and then going into church life. So and then he became a bishop. And then he figured out, he got to know Henry a little bit, and then he saw his own way to power. So he's very ambitious, he's very smart, he's very clever. So Wolsey decides, if I can just get him what he wants, I will have everything from him. And he's right. So first he starts this business, he sees what Henry does with the jousting, he sees his chance. So instead of putting the brakes on, he encourages him to do it more. And then they decide they're going to attack us. In the meantime, Henry had wanted to, bestow certain benefits on people, whatnot. And the Lord Privy Seal, Bishop Fox, and Bishop Warham wouldn't let it do it, because anything Henry did had to go the course of the seals. And this goes all the way back to Henry II of Thomas Becket fame. So several hundred years earlier. So first, Henry would write something, then it has to go to the Lord, first to his secretary, makes a copy, the Lord Privy Seal makes a copy, stamps it. Then it goes to the Lord High Chancellor, who's Warham, Bishop of Canterbury, he stamps it, and then it goes on. So now, the course of the seals prevented Henry from more or less doing exactly what he wanted. So Wolsey and Henry proposed to challenge it on the grounds that it's mere convention. So the first thing that Henry does is have Wolsey give some appointment, and then Warham throws a fit about it. So then Wolsey writes an airtight legal case to show that the king can do this by the royal prerogative, and the course of the seals is not part of common law. It's merely a convention that can be dispensed with, and the king hereby dispenses with it. which opens the door. So then, you know, Warham yields, because Warham was also not a particularly confrontational guy. He didn't want to actually deal with fights and problems. And this, unfortunately, will lead to the downfall of the English church. He's no Thomas of Canterbury. So he yields, and Wolsey makes his way, and Henry's so pleased with Wolsey. So then Wolsey, you know, manages to arrange this whole military campaign in France. Louis XII is away in Italy, and so the French are distracted. Henry invades France, takes several castles, including the city of Terouanne. He besieges it, and then while the French attempted to throw provisions over the castle walls, and when they came to do this, the English charged, and the French cavalry ran away. So they were called, it's called the Battle of the Spurs, because you can see this, the French spurs kicking up in the distance to spur the horses.
Running away. I was going to say they're running away. They're fleeing. They're fleeing the fight, and leaving the castle for Henry. Let me just do a station ID here. This is the Mike Church Show here on the Crusade Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network, radio the way it should be, and we're in the middle of our homage to St. John Fisher on the day that he was martyred in 1535. And we're with our expert, our special guest on the subject here, Ryan Grant, who is the editor of the Life and Times of St. John Fisher, a book which you can get at mediatrixpress.com. And don't forget, if you miss any or all part of this show, we are also making a video presentation of this broadcast as we speak. They will both be available for download for Founders Pass members immediately following the conclusion of this show. So if you want to download them, you'll have access to both of them for members. And we'll have a lengthy preview for people that are not members. And if you'd like to become a member and support our work here, you can do so by going to VeritasRadioNetwork.com. And for as little as 23 cents per day, become a Founders Pass member and gain instant download and streaming access to this episode and all of the other great original content that is presented on a daily basis here on this radio station, the Crusade Channel. Just go to VeritasRadioNetwork.com/join or call 866-483-3833. That's 866-483-3833. The Veritas Radio Network, radio the way it should be. So we'll pick up with a story here, and we have about 45 minutes left here to squeeze the remainder of our tail in. Maybe we could pick up the players are in place. We don't meet Cranmer until later in the story, right?
Not till the end. So just to bring it around then, to bring us back to Fisher.
Okay.
Henry, you know, gets this great prestige. He gets these castles in France, but you know they're enormously expensive, and he can't manage it. So he has to, you know, step back. And we'll come back to the international scene in a little bit. So then he ends up having to take away his garrison there, which is, you know, kind of a big defeat. But he's planning to do more, right? And so England's back on the European map, so to speak, rather than this kind of insignificant podunk country out in the middle of nowhere. So now Fisher, as the Bishop of Rochester, is now famed also as the greatest preacher in the kingdom. So as I mentioned, when Henry VII and Lady Margaret Beaufort died, he was appointed to preach at their funerals. Right? And he preached a really great sermon about the realities of this world. So he says, his loud and commendation of King Henry VII, he says, "Let no man think that mine intent," this is Fisher, by the way, "is for to praise him for any vain transitory things of this life, which by the example of him, all kings and princes may learn how sliding, how slippery, how failing they be. Albeit he had as much of them as was possible in manner for any king to have, his politic wisdom and governance, it was singular, his wit always quick and ready, his reason pithy and substantial, substantial, his memory fresh and holding, his experience notable, his counsels fortunate, and taken by wise deliberation, his speech gracious in diverse languages, his person goodly and amiable, his natural complexion of the purest mixture, his issue fair and in good number, leagues and confederacies he had with all Christian princes, his mighty power was dread everywhere, not only within his realm, but without also. His people were to him as humble a subjection as ever they were to a king, his land many a day in peace and tranquility, his prosperity in battle against his enemies was marvelous, his dealing in time of perils and dangers was cold and sober, with great hardness. If any treason was conspired against him, it came out wonderfully. His treasure and riches incomparable, his buildings most goodly, and after the newest cast all of pleasure. But what is all this now as unto him, all but fumus et umbra, as smoke that soon vanisheth, and a shadow soon passeth away? Shall I praise him then for them? Nay, forsooth. So now he says this, and he goes on with a great allusion to classical things, to Alexander the Great and Pompey and Caesar. He says, well, where are they now? You know, and he continues this great panegyric for Henry VII. And, of course, the young Henry VIII, expectant king, you know, was present to listen to this. But obviously, you know, he didn't heed the warning very much. So, and there's many more things that could be said in that particular panegyric. But nevertheless, so Fisher gets renowned as a great preacher. So let's talk a little bit about his virtues and his holiness as a bishop. So even though his income is slight, he took whatever means to succor the needs of the poor. So poor and needy would often come to the bishop's residence, and he would give them whatever he needed. In an age where the bishop couldn't be seen, it often whipped people coming by asking for alms. He was there giving alms, right? He becomes this model bishop. Fisher would go into towns to actually preach on the street corner as the bishop. And then, let alone in the churches, then he would even go into the houses. So it's recorded in the earliest life of John Fisher that he went into the houses of the peasants. So remember, these are, you know, a lot of them thatched roofs, wood, and of course not very good chimneys. And so the smoke sometimes would fill the house. And he would go in and hear people's confessions and give them the last rites in the sacrament of anointing as they were on their deathbed. But even though none of his servants could stand the house because of the smell of the smoke, he would still be there yet. He fasted very frequently, and so he had a very, you know, peculiar diet, which is why, of course, in the end, he's so exceedingly frail, right? Because his fasting is so strong. We can talk about other things in there, but he has a, an absolute devotion to preaching the people. He said, if I preacheth not to the people, I shall be damned. Well, I wonder how many bishops, you know, today ever think, you know, even think like that. And some of them do, hopefully, but nevertheless, even at that time, he's about the only one.
If we just paused a minute and waited, hold on. I can tell you exactly how many bishops that we can personally attest actually do that.
0.0.
Okay, let's move on, shall we?
Yes, indeed. So Fisher, does all these things and is always, ready to assist anyone in need. He's also, now heresy had been a problem, and I mentioned you have the specter of John Wycliffe in England. Now, Wycliffe is in the 14th century. Before him, heresy had not really been any real problem in England at all. But now, Wycliffe was very anti-clerical. He took the view that the ministers and the church bishops and popes, when they had their office, only so long as they preached the gospel. Once they failed to do that, then they had no office whatsoever. And the problem is that, again, subjective criterion of when they are and are not actually doing that, or do they do it through others or whatnot. So Wycliffe is very anti-clerical. And one of the things, and so I mentioned earlier, there were translations of the Bible as a result of mostly the printing press, but also of its humanism, mostly the New Testament, in German, and prior to Luther, and in French, and in Spanish, and even in Italian, but not in English, and it's because of Wycliffe. Wycliffe decides that because he wants to get the people raised against the church establishment, and you can't really do that unless you have a means, of educating them. Well, there's no time and not enough people to educate them all in Latin, and they couldn't be taken from their work to do that anyway. But what if we could give them the Bible in their own language? Each man now interprets the scripture instead of the priest and the bishop. And that's what he did. So he set out with a whole team of, translators to translate. I don't even think they did all of the Bible, but they did good portions of it, especially all the New Testament, into English. But it was very rough English, and because they had so much reverence for the Vulgate, they refused to even change the grammatical order. So it did come out very awkward in English. But one of the things that Wycliffe did that guaranteed the condemnation of the church, and he knew it, and he rather actually favored doing it this way, was to purposely mistranslate terms that the church had always understood as referring to priests and bishops, and simply change it to elder and minister, and get rid of entirely all the language of it, clerical language that's used in the New Testament. So, and that, and amongst another number of other heresies. So then, of course, he was tried and he was burned. And so the church then had this problem of people who would, there were the Lollards, the people that followed Wycliffe. and held to his teaching. And they were very small and very scattered. And sometimes they start preaching in different places and people might hear it and listen. So sometimes some poor unlearned fellow would listen to this stuff and start spouting it out. And then they get reported for heresy or something. So when Fisher ever got cases like these, he would sit down to them, he would treat them very nicely, and he would just talk to them and try to discover why they think that. And then after, you know, just general conversation, every single person that was ever brought to Fisher for heresy in the Diocese of Rochester made an abjuration. Nobody was ever condemned under Fisher. The only time is if sometimes Fisher assisted in heresy trials later for other bishops, and then sometimes in those cases, they voted to put certain people to death. But in this case, Fisher never burned anyone in Rochester. And now sometimes some people are like, oh yeah, and they tortured people, right? You try to impute some of the mythology of the Spanish Inquisition. Well, in England, it was against the law to torture anyone except for treason, even in the church. And so there was no torture in pre-Reformation England, even for a heresy trial. It never happened. And because there's copious records and it just can't be found there. And even though some of that appears in John Fox, for example, in Acts and Monuments and stuff. So as we go on to further things, so Fisher was always very, very mild, and he hated the idea, because the membership of the church was so important to him, that one occasion a Lutheran had defaced a papal proclamation in Cambridge, when it had St. John's in Cambridge, which I'll mention in a minute. And so Fisher had announced that whoever had done it, if he shall not appear, appear within so many days so as to receive, approbation and forgiveness, if he's truly penitent, then he will have to be suffered an excommunication. And though men know not who he is, God will know. And then when he did it, he suffered so much he couldn't even pronounce it. And according to the early biographer, everyone was brought to tears because of the fact that he loved the church and the soul so much he couldn't bear to pronounce the excommunication. He just didn't want to do it. So St. John's Cambridge, and it's still there today. In fact, the front gate of St. John's you can still see. I haven't seen it personally. I've only seen pictures. I've never been to England. But it was completed. John Fisher watched its completion. It was built with the funds left to him in Lady Margaret's will when she died. So St. John established St. John's College, Cambridge, all its statutes and institutions, which essentially was the seminary system that later would be enacted by Trent, but without that name. Right, so St. John's College, Cambridge had special rules in which people were, and they had to vow to do them, so it became a private vow. So if you broke it, it was blasphemy. So it was this private rule that you had to, of course, be in attendance for the divine office. You had to be able to speak and read Latin and fluently. You had to be able to, follow these various courses of study. And it was a very well drawn out system. So he basically created the seminary system. And anyone that had a vocation, even very poor, he would find that they could go to St. John's College and be trained there. He made a special intention of personally ordaining anyone who was destined for his diocese. So, and there were about 42 people that were ordained for the Diocese of Rochester. Fisher ordained 39 of them. By comparison, in the Bishop of Lincoln, there was about 112 priests during his time, and he had ordained about 3 of them. So Fisher was absolutely directly involved in every single, ordering the priest. If ever there was any case of a priest abusing his office, he was duly punished. Fisher didn't tolerate clerical abuse in any fashion, which at that time was financial still.
So, Ryan, we're about at the two-thirds mark on our show here today, and I want to make sure that we have time to get to the controversy and Fisher's debate with Luther, and then flesh out what it was that led him to his disagreement, his serious disagreement with Henry, and how was it that Henry then set up St. John Fisher to be ultimately tried and then found guilty of treason, I think he was found guilty of treason, and then executed. And we have about 35 minutes to do that. So, and we have to take one more break. So why don't we take our break here, and when we come back, why don't we pick up, folks, if you want the detail, and Ryan's given us such fantastic detail, I suggest that you get the book at MediatrixPress.com, Life and Times of St. John Fisher, to flesh in all the details. So when we come back, why don't we try to pick up where we left off with this and begin with the story of St. John Fisher and his disagreement and the controversy that he runs into with Martin Luther, or Father Luther, And then how it is that Henry gets into the Henry VIII ultimately gets into this conflict with not only St. John Fisher, but with the Catholic Church, and then with he's Sir Thomas More at the time. And then ultimately, we'll get to the martyrdom of St. John Fisher. And it's just a tragically sad, yet glorious martyr story. So you don't want to miss any of this. We'll take a time out here. This is the Mike Church Show here on the Crusade Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network. And I have that song that Ryan had mentioned earlier. The Pastime with Good Company that was, I guess, written by Henry or by Fisher. And we'll drop the commercial with this. We'll come back here on the Crusade Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network, radio the way it should be.
war, 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 kill, 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 Americans don't.
Ah, you fool! You fell victim to one of the classic blunders. The most famous is never get involved in a land war in Asia.
The Mike Tech Show. The daily beacon of chivalry and peace. For brides and princesses. Heard exclusively crusading. Here on the Veritas Radio Network's Crusade.
The Veritas Radio Network, radio the way it should be. It's a very special live presentation of our show, which is in homage and in commemoration of the martyrdom of St. John Fisher, who was martyred on this day in 1522. And we have been joined all during the course of this broadcast by our expert, Ronan Grant, who has edited a fresh copy of The Life and Times of St. John Fisher, a great book. I suggest you pick a copy up, especially if you're into biographies of the saints, and we could all learn a lot from the saints, especially martyrs like St. John Fisher in their life and times. If you like what you're hearing here on the Crusade Channel, folks, we are a for-profit entity here, and we are a startup. We began on the 15th of November 2015, and we continue to work very hard to bring you fresh, original, live radio programming that you can't get anywhere else. So we're not a podcasting company. We're not a recording company. We are a radio broadcasting company. That's why this show is presented live for your enjoyment today. There will be recorded versions on audio and video available to Founders Pass members immediately following the conclusion of this show at VeritasRadioNetwork.com. And if you're not a member, you can subscribe to the Founders Pass for as little as 23 cents per day. And you can also choose between a monthly or yearly membership. And during June, for every new Founders Pass yearly membership purchase, we'll ship you an autographed copy of Washington Irving's Life of Washington, Volume 1, in hardback, edited by yours truly, for free. Don't cost nothing. That's a $50 value if you become a Founders Pass yearly member today. And our June fundraising and membership totals are a little lagging behind, so we certainly appreciate you signing up today. Simply go to VeritasRadioNetwork.com/join and sign up today, or call 866-483-3833. Veritas Radio Network, radio the way it should be. So, we've got a great, marvelous history of the late 16th century, early 16th century England, the life and times of King Henry VII and now King Henry VIII, and what church life was like at the time. And as we've seen, there was some corruption that ultimately would lead to Father Luther's revolt. And Luther and Fisher would butt heads in an ecclesiastical battle. And our expert here, Ryan Grant, is here to tell us that part of the story. And then we'll get into the part of the story where Henry VIII and his controversy comes in. And then finally and ultimately, the martyrdom of St. John Fisher. So let's pick up with how is it that St. John Fisher, or he's Bishop Fisher now at this time, how does he run into, and what is his confrontation or his controversy with Father Luther?
Well, Fisher gets a reputation as a celebrated theologian, starting with an earlier debate with a French humanist named Lefebvre. Lefebvre had thought that challenged whether the Latin tradition that Mary Magdalene was the sinful woman, and a couple other figures mentioned in the Gospels. And he had argued that following the Greek tradition, there are three different people. Now, St. John Fisher thought this was dangerous to the devotion to Mary Magdalene, so he argued against it. And it was a celebrated book. It got a lot of attention, and so it put him on the map as a famous intellectual. He was a very great friend of Erasmus of Rotterdam, who we can't talk about here, not enough time. And then later, of course, of More. So he got more and more into scholarly circles. And then Luther came on the scene. Now, Luther comes on the scene as a result of Julius II and Leo X's determination to rebuild St. Peter's, patronize Renaissance art, make war all throughout Italy to recover papal fiefdoms and keep the papal treasury full enough to keep paying Raphael and Bramante and Michelangelo. So then the preachers they sent to preach on the whole questions of indulgences exceed their authority. Now, it's important to understand an indulgence, even Catholics today have this kind of mixed up. An indulgence didn't, first of all, no one taught that an indulgence forgave your mortal sins, that is, that could get you to heaven. An indulgence cannot get you to heaven. You're either saved or you're not. And if you're not saved, an indulgence is not going to make you saved. Secondly, sometimes you'll see these things in old books, you know, indulgence of like 300 days, and people think, oh, that's 300 days off my time in purgatory. That's not the case either. What it is, it adds the value of having performed that work for 300 days to the church's spiritual treasury so that that merit then can be applied to the souls in purgatory where it need, because no theologians ever determine, and there's nothing in scripture to determine how long your time in purgatory is, or even if that accounts like time on earth. So for that, you know, so that was where the crisis begins. So the Dominican Tetzel comes into Germany preaching indulgences. One of the things he does, he transfers the right of commissioning indulgences from the Augustinian monastery in Wittenberg, where indulgences had funded the studies of a certain Father Martin Luther, to the Dominican convent in Wittenberg. And so the Augustinians are up in arms about this, so the superior orders Martin Luther, Father Martin Luther, to do an investigation on indulgences, and the fruit of that was the 95 Theses. And that's how that had come about, right? And so contrary to Luther, was perfectly fine with indulgences as long as he was, you know, raking in some cash out of it. But once it became... you know, once it got, they weren't getting the cash anymore. Now it was a problem. So he puts the disputation up, and thus Luther becomes this instant celebrity. Eventually, then he starts as a Catholic reformer, but he starts moving with new doctrines, basically. So first is that he issued 40 or so articles that were the explanation of his faith. And so Pope Leo X wrote a condemnation of his articles, Exsurge Domine. And that bull was an informal papal document that condemned Luther's position. So Luther got so incensed, how dare the Pope of Rome attack me? And he had already gone as far at this point as called the Pope the Antichrist. And so he publicly, he wrote a document reasserting all his articles and publicly burned Pope Leo X's bull, Exsurge Domine, right. Leo X, the first Medici Pope. So then, so Henry VIII sees a chance to enter the fray here, right? He hadn't been so successful in war, so now he's going to, you know, enter into the fray in terms of the defending the church. And so he writes a book called The Defense of the Seven Sacraments Against the Errors of Martin Luther. Nicely gets back those days, they loved like nice lengthy titles, especially in Latin. So he writes this. In the meantime, Fisher had been alarmed by what he read in Luther's article. So Fisher had been working on a work called the Refutation of Luther's Assertions of His Articles. And so he was working on that article by article. It's a massive work, by the way. It's very big.
Okay.
But aside that, so Henry writes his book on the seven sacraments. Now, some people like to claim, and you see this even today in scholarship, some people claim that Fisher really wrote this book, but it's simply not true. And it can't stand up to any serious scrutiny of the text. Henry writes like a well-instructed layman, and that comes out in the defense of the seven sacraments. He makes good arguments, but it's written the way a well-instructed layman, not a professional theologian, would write. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that, interesting little tidbit here, when the book was written, Thomas More, he was an editor, basically, that he put together various papers and edited it, and he came to Henry, and when he read Henry's dedicatory epistle to Pope Leo X, he said, maybe you better leave this part out, because it was a great, passionate defense of the divine office of the papacy. Now, More, as a humanist, had followed Erasmus's opinion that the papacy was not a divine institution, that it was merely a human institution. And so he thought that maybe this should be left out. But Henry ignored him, having been instructed since youth that the papacy is a divine institution. And so he continued with this passionate defense, right? Which, amusing, you wonder, how? How could it be this you know, flipped 10 years hence? And we'll see how that plays out. So, you know, Henry has a courier take this book straight away to the Pope, and the Pope is so excited that a monarch is now with excellent argumentation defending the church that he grants Henry the title Fidei Defensor, which you can still see FD on British coinage today. They appropriated that to themselves, even though the Pope never meant it to be hereditary. But in any event, so Henry then, you know, is so pleased about this that the Pope, he's going to formally publish the Pope's bull, Exsurge Domino, in England. So it's going to have, you know, force of law there. And he has a big ceremony to commemorate it, as well as burning of Lutheran books and pamphlets. And he appoints the greatest preacher of the day, St. John Fisher, to preach the sermon. Now, unfortunately, Henry got sick, so he couldn't show up to all this. So Fisher then began preaching, and it made a very big impression on all the ambassadors present, anyway, on the errors of Luther. And then and he stops and he mentions the book written by our king, the King of England. And then Wolsey picks up the book and waves it around, Henry's book, waves it around so everyone can see. There's this great cheering of all the crowds and everything. And it's great stagecraft. So Wolsey is, if anything, the spin doctor in chief, the great stage manager of Henry's whole monarchy, really. And unfortunately, we can't talk more about Wolsey, maybe another time. But so then, you know, so Fisher does this, and then Luther reads Henry's book, and then he's indignant, and he responds. But he doesn't answer any of Henry's arguments. He basically just responds by calling him names and giving him all kinds of abuse. So Fisher then takes up his pen to respond to Luther, and what he does is that he writes a defense of the royal assertion against Luther's work, the De Babylonica Captivitate, which is against the Babylonian captivity of the Church of Luther. So in that book, Luther basically argued that there's only, originally he argued there were three true sacraments, later he reduces it to two, namely that baptism, penance, and the bread, and then later he gets rid of bread being Eucharist, and then he gets rid of penance, and so it's just two. And he says, you know, mixed in with these popish ceremonies and all these other things. So, and he also, that's where he throws out the book of James, the epistle of James from the New Testament and other places. That's the work where he does it. So now Fisher realized what nobody else realized, because he was a brilliant theologian. And when he read Luther's work, he realized that it's all underpinned by Luther's belief in faith alone, that faith alone will save you. So this is what would help. Even the Pope's theologians hadn't picked up on this particular element. They just can condemn these peripheral things. Fisher's the only one who points his finger at it. And that's why the Council of Trent cites and bases itself on Fisher more than any other theologian, including St. Thomas Aquinas. And furthermore, Fisher is the old one, cited more than any other contemporary theologian at the Council of Trent, because he had so thoroughly smashed Luther. And Luther never said a word. He responded to anybody who wrote against him, whether you're Catholic or Protestant, it didn't matter. But in this case, he didn't have a word to say, because here's the holiest bishop in Christendom, who's known for being very holy. He's reputed to be the best theologian in Christendom, and his arguments are unanswerable. So Luther just kind of, just better not to even try to address it, will look worse. So here's an example of that. I'll give a quick from my translation of it, which is still in progress. And actually, anyone listening to this now, this is the only time probably anyone will ever have heard this.
You're translating Luther, you're translating Fisher.
Fisher is not his response. Because he wrote it in Latin.
Okay.
He wrote it for the scholarly audience in England. The only one of Fisher's Latin works was ever translated, and that was by Hallett. It was the Defense of the Priesthood, and it's unfindable now. I'm not sure why. I haven't been able to come by a copy yet. So if anyone finds a copy, I'll reprint it. But otherwise, so I'm working on a translation of this work, his defense of Henry's assertion against Luther. So I'll just read a brief section for just a minute or so. Right off the beginning, actually. Nobody's heard this before except a handful of people, and certainly never in English.
All right.
In the beginning, we shall expand upon the audacity of Luther, whereby he is certain that his doctrines are from heaven. I do not know here which doctrines Luther would have us understand are from heaven. For if he shall say they are pleasing decrees of Christ, I oppose nothing, since this will have been from heaven. But if, on the contrary, he means those which are besides the sense of the words of Christ, then Luther incorrectly adds these from his own mind. But by no means are they from heaven, and these alone can be called the Lutheran doctrines. For the rest are not of Luther, but of Christ. Such things are without a doubt, as often as he either introduces heresies diametrically opposed to the institutes of the Holy Fathers, or else when he interprets scriptures for his insane frenzied chapters, or at length, when he, in his rashness, he condemns or rejects as though condemned in the same way scriptures which hitherto, being received by the church, merely for not squaring with his arguments. Moreover, he especially condemns the Epistle of James. It's the only place in the Bible, by the way, it's not the Fisher, by the way, but this is the only place in the Bible where it says faith alone, and it says faith alone will not save you. So anyway, so therefore, you know, the fact that Luther throws it out doesn't square with him.
So without a doubt,
because it's opposed clearly to his heresies. He scoffs that it can hardly be apostolic, even though it was approved by each individual father of the church and also among the Catholic epistles by the universal church. But I draw your attention, reader, to his scoffing. For Luther writes thus in his commentary on the first epistle of Blessed Peter. Thence it is easily learned that the epistle titled by the name of James is scarcely an apostolic epistle. For you read nearly nothing concerning the matters of faith, not an article of faith, not even the resurrection, which should be present here. And there's altogether no consolation or hope, and everything Christ did and suffered would be in vain. Unquote. That's Luther. So Fisher picks up again. Here, reader, you can see the reason Luther denies the Epistle of James, that the Epistle of James is apostolic, because there James makes no mention of the resurrection. But if for that reason James's epistle will not seem to be apostolic, then neither are certain epistles of Paul, especially the one to Philemon and both epistles to Timothy. Neither will these be apostolic when in these there is no word contained about the resurrection. Add that in this number, neither the second epistle of Peter, which Luther still approves of as apostolic, would be apostolic, since even in that Peter says nothing on the resurrection. Why, if Luther's sophistry were to be admitted, we would need to reject many things from the epistles that the church receives. Right? And so there's that little excerpt. That's actually the very first articles of that book, The Defense of Henry's Assertion Against Luther.
Incredible.
So he writes several more, and then also the great work against the Lutheran Oecolampadius, where Oecolampadius had written this work to show that what the church fathers taught on the changed basically what the church fathers taught in the Eucharist. He actually inserted things, he omitted things. So Fisher showed what a dishonest scholar he was in defending the Holy Eucharist. So he gets then now celebrated as the greatest theologian in Europe. But now there's a problem brewing back home, right? And so briefly, because we're really close to out of time, Henry, now, as I mentioned, Henry and More. Henry believes that the papacy is divided and More doesn't. Well, Fisher's clear argumentation from the scriptures, the fathers, and tradition is so convincing that More changes his opinion. He abandons Erasmus's opinion and comes to see that the papacy is divided. And he admits as much in a letter, a great tribute to John Fisher, he wrote in about 1528. So now Henry goes on the course where he starts to have some doubts. The marriage to Catherine didn't prove fruitful. He had one daughter, Mary Tudor, and Catherine was supposed to bring political alliance as, you know, being related to the Habsburgs and the most powerful man in all of Europe, Charles V, the King of Spain, the Holy Roman Emperor, the Lord of Flanders, Burgundy, Sicily, South Italy. This is the guy who was, you know, the dude in Europe. So him and Francis I of France have been fighting it out. And Henry's been kind of on the sidelines, brought in here and there. He's brought in on the side of the empire. And then, you know, with the promise that he'll get various territories in France, right? So various years, Henry goes to war with the French, and Charles V never materialized on the battlefield. Finally, 1525, Henry says, I'm not going to go this year. He's not going to show up. He's just playing around. Well, 1525 is the Battle of Pavia. Charles V takes Francois I captured, prisoner, and then his sons as captives. And then Henry realizes the mistake. So he writes real quick to Charles V, let's partition France. And Charles V calls his bluff. Well, if you want your part of France, you got to take it. So quickly, he and Wolsey try to get the money. So Wolsey, a spin doctor in chief, calls it the amicable grant. It's a forced loan, like a forced tax. You got to give the king X amount of money so he can go to war. It's so unpopular that even Henry's supporters kind of back away. Everyone refuses to do it. So Henry had to drop it. And if he died there, he would have been an insignificant English king that tried to get England on the map and failed. So instead then, something else happens, which is, so Catherine, of course, now just seems useless to him, and she hasn't given the son. Now she's in her 40s. There's no way she's going to have a son. And so now he just kind of loses heart. And, of course, he's had mistresses for a while. And then at some point, nobody knows when it happened, Anne Boleyn shows up in the picture. Now, Anne Boleyn was a courtier in France. She had witnessed court life very closely. She was excellent in French. She was witty. She was charming. She was also of Lutheran opinion, so that doesn't really clearly show his head until much later. Nevertheless, she charms Henry, so Henry decides, oh, yeah, good, another mistress. So he, you know, sends her a letter, you know, basically wanting to be her mistress. She says, no, I'm not going to do it. She tells the king's, you know, ministers who are trying to facilitate this. Nope. And then Henry gets, you know, this drives him crazy. Wow, who can, she told me no? But there's nothing I can really do about
nothing
this.
I can do.
Exactly. Cut her head off
right,
for that.
Right.
Not yet.
Not yet.
But, not yet.
So I'll then, get around to her, but not yet. Not at this moment.
No, 1535, 1536, on the other hand. That's when the reckoning comes. But anyway, but that'll be because once the whole thing's over and Anne Boleyn passes from royal mistress to queen, she's expected to be subservient and everything. Now she's tamed, essentially. But she wouldn't be tamed. She still wanted to manage Henry as she did before. They get at loggerheads. Finally, Henry decides to take care of the situation, so then he has her executed on these trumped-up charges, which are patently absurd. And then has her beheaded. So anyway, that's another story we can't get to. So back to Fisher now. So Fisher has this high reputation and everything, and he actually gets consulted. He gets consulted by Wolsey. Henry's trying to work out the arguments. How can I get out of this? Because Anne Boleyn won't have carnal relations with him unless she's the queen. Henry's in a dilemma. Well, I really want this, but I can't have it. How do I get her to be my queen? Well, I got to get rid of the old queen. But I can't murder her because that would be an outrage and I'd be in war with the empire. Maybe, let's see. So he's working on these details. So he gets people like Wolsey together and they work up this argument from Leviticus. He who marries his brother's widow is an unclean thing and they shall be barren. Well, he's working this out. He's like, yeah, that explains it. That's why I don't have a son. That's why things aren't working in France. That's why, you know, all these problems are coming up. So now he comes to this conclusion that his marriage isn't valid. And whether it was real or not, at the very least, we know much later it wasn't real because he's trying to claim this whole time the Pope, couldn't dispense him from Leviticus, right? The problem is Henry had also had adulterous relations with Anne Boleyn's older sister, Mary Boleyn. So as a result, that also falls under the same verse in Leviticus, right? And so he actually, during this whole process, he actually asked the Pope to dispense him from his adulterous relations with Mary Boleyn in order to marry Anne. The very same dispensation he's claiming the Pope could not do for Catherine. So obviously we kind of see what's really going on in his mind here. And that was confirmed when someone had smuggled love letters between Anne and Henry out and into Rome. They're actually in the Vatican archives today, and written in French. And so it, so the Pope obviously sitting there, Clement VII, yeah, conscience, eh? Wow, conscience, got it. And so the whole thing escalates. So Wolsey goes to see John Fisher as the principal theologian to solicit his support, starts asking him questions about Leviticus. Fisher knows what's going on. So then he answers him that, well, some of the fathers interpret Leviticus as divine law, but the section in Deuteronomy, which says that you need to take up your brother's widow in order to raise children to her name, that you read these together so that if he should die with no issue, then you take up your brother's wife, but otherwise you don't. And so that's what some fathers say. Others, however, see Leviticus is not divine law, but ceremonial law, right? So that's the other argument. And Fisher makes that case too in many of his books. So Fisher then is summoned eventually to Henry, and he sees Henry and he talks to Henry. And, you know, tells him, you need have no more conscience in issues with this. And he explains to Henry the whole thing. So they parted, but the early biographer says at that point he knew he no longer had the king's favor in anything. Because Henry was determined he was going to get what he's going to get. And he was a determined guy. St. Thomas More said that to his son-in-law, Roper, he said, son Roper, I tell you, if my head would win him a castle in France, it should not fail to fall. So this is the kind of guy we're dealing with.
So
Henry gets a court of inquest. Wolsey is in charge of it. So Wolsey is the cardinal legatee. That means he's the Pope's representative in England. He could have rubber stamped the whole thing in a canonical process and sent it off, but he realized.
But he didn't. Ryan, we have just about 5 minutes left to wrap this up here. It's my church show here on the Crusade Channel, part of the Veritas Radio Network. Radio the way it should be. It's a very special live edition of the Mike Church Show here. And we're not using here, we are using a rebroadcast this afternoon, but since today is the Martyrdom Day of St. John Fisher, we've been the last 2 hours going over the life and times of St. John. And we're going to have to now just fast forward to Henry can't get his way. He can't get John Fisher to go along with him, and he can't get Thomas More to go along. And the Pope tells him no. He writes, he sends his whole case to the Pope without Fisher's approval, right?
Wolsey and Cardinal Campeggio, they come to nothing, mostly because of Fisher, actually. Fisher gives such a rousing defense. See, at this time, More was kind of had retired off to not be so much in sight. Fisher is the one who actively takes up the case to defend Catherine and puts himself right in the sights of Henry's guns. Literally, as the early biographer says, that Anne Boleyn's father, Thomas Boleyn, had actually shot a cannon into one of Fisher's residences. So so Fisher gets himself in the crosshairs. Eventually, Henry puts all the machinery in place by putting in new laws that declare he's the head of the Church of England. The clergy are all terrified. They give in and give him this against Fisher's objections. And Bishop Warham, again, was very weak. Henry puts in a new law, or revives an old law, goes back to Edward I, called Praemunire. And it says that if anyone appeals across the sea to the Pope, it's treasonous. So then, you know, it's basically a subtle denial of papal authority right there. So Henry puts all the machinery in place to break from Rome if he gets an unfavorable answer, and he does. Pope Clement VII declares Henry's marriage to Catherine to be valid. So Henry had put in place, so Bishop Warham dies, and Thomas Cranmer is put in. Cranmer is one of the dodgiest characters in all of English history.
Yeah.
And we can't talk too much more about him. So Cranmer then officiates the marriage. He does whatever Henry wants. So he is actually legitimately the bishop there, and as the Bishop of Canterbury. So he secretly marries Henry and Anne Boleyn pregnant at this time, declares Catherine's marriage to have been invalid. She's now simply the Princess Dowager. And now they put in through Parliament the Act of Succession. More had resigned from the chancellorship. Ironically, he opened up the same Parliament, which would later put in the laws that condemn him. It's called the Reformation Parliament, starting in 1529. They put in the Act of Succession. You must accept the marriage of Henry VIII and Anne Boleyn and their issue as the legitimate successor heirs to the kingdom. So Fisher and Moore are both brought in to swear. Moore is quiet, but Moore snubbed the official coronation of Anne Boleyn. So he got in the crosshairs because he was too important a personage to not be present. So they both get brought in to swear before Cromwell. There's many other things going on in here, and you could read these in the book, but the nut of the matter is. Then Fisher and Moore both agree to swear to one aspect of the Act of Succession only, not to the preamble, which declares Catherine's marriage invalid and Anne the legitimate queen. But they do swear to hold their issue, that is their children, as the true heirs of the kingdom. Because if Fisher said, you know, kings and, you know, Parliament can affect whoever they wish to be the successor. So we can't brook any problem with that. But they wouldn't swear to the whole act. And because they wouldn't swear to the whole act, they were put in the Tower. So, and they both agreed never, no matter what, because they knew they would be lied to told the other had given in, and never to give in or believe the other one actually broke. And they did pass notes between them for encouragement and different things. Moore had access to his books, but Fisher did not. So while he's in the Tower, he composed a spiritual consolation, readied himself. Then they came up with a new vehicle, the Act of Royal Supremacy, which is the blueprint of the modern Leviathan of the state. And it basically declares the king, the supreme head of the Church of England, Ecclesia Anglicana, and not the Pope, basically. And so it's a point of basically Henry is the supreme god of church and state. He has more authority in the Church of England than the Pope has in the Universal Church, let alone in the English Church. And of course, remember that Annates tax, that first year of the bishop's income you're supposed to pay to the Pope? Now it's paid to Henry. And as a result, it remained until the 20th century. You had to pay the Annates tax, whereas the Catholic Church had gotten rid of it in the 16th century. How's that for Reformation? But anyway.
And now this winds up, we're over time and out of time. Let's go ahead and wrap this up and fast forward, because I have to get to another recording here, unfortunately. But we're at pretend we're at the 21st of June, 1535. Walking through the end of the life, and we could pick this up on another episode and flesh out some more of this history.
Fisher is taken to is in the Tower, and then he's approached by someone who says, I'm the king's trusty minister, and he only wants to know what your real feelings of the matter are, because the Act of Royal Supremacy said to think otherwise than accept the king's headship was treason, to think maliciously was treason. So, you know, so Fisher said, you promise it's not going to be held against me? He fell for it. just because the man swore an oath, and so he thought nobody's going to perjure his oath, right? Well, and they think in history maybe this was Richard Rich, just like with Thomas More. Nobody's really sure. Everyone knows the story of Thomas More. Of course, he did a lie, as it didn't work with More. So then Fisher's brought into court, and he answers himself that he never maliciously thought any treason against his lord. And then they bring up, Richard Rich, or presumably, it's what William Rastell says. He was present, at least for Fisher's execution. Then they bring up this thing. Well, you said you didn't accept it. He said, well, I did, but what of that? You swore under oath that it wouldn't be used. He said, well, it doesn't matter. You spoke against the royal supremacy, so you're going to be put to death. So they bring Fisher back. And that night, he was in a miserable condition and very, very withered, bag of bones at that point almost. And that's how he was described when they saw him. And so he is woken up by the guard to be put to death, and he's already prepared to do it gladly. He's old, failing. And so the early biographer adds an account of this incident. He says, and as they were come to the uttermost precinct of or liberty of the tower, they rested there with him space, till such a time as one was sent before to know in what readiness the sheriffs were to receive him. During which space he rose out of his chair, and standing on his feet, leaned his shoulder to the wall, lifting his eyes up toward heaven. He opened his little book, that is his New Testament, in his hand, and said, O Lord, this is the last time that I shall ever open this book. Let some comfortable place now chance me whereby I, thy poor servant, may glorify thee in this my last hour. And with that, looking into the book, the first thing that came to me, and it's read in Latin, I'll just read the English real quick.
Yeah, we got to wrap this up. One more minute.
All right, so this is why I say he sent his Lord Jesus.
He's calling. Thank you. We'll pick this up on another occasion, and I'd like to do with Henry until the end here. I think we can make another 2-hour show out of that. Folks, this has been the Mike Church Show.